moviendo.
And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.
And welcome to all of our listeners and viewers around the country and around the world. Massive labor protests in the state of Wisconsin have entered their fifth day. On Thursday, 30,000 teachers, students, and state and municipal workers took part in a noontime rally at the State House in Madison to oppose Wisconsin Republican Governor Scott Walker's attempt to eliminate almost all collective bargaining rights for most public workers, as well as slash their pay and benefits. Another 20,000 people took part in a rally last night at the state capitol. Public schools in Madison are closed for the third day in a row as teachers continue to protest. The Republican-controlled state Senate was scheduled to vote on the measure Thursday. But Democratic senators took an extraordinary measure by refusing to show up for the vote, leaving the Republicans without a quorum. The Democratic senators have now left the state.
Joining us in Madison is John Nichols, the Madison-based reporter who is the Washington correspondent for The Nation magazine, goes back generations in Wisconsin. Also with us in Madison is Susan Stern, a first-grade teacher who's been taking part in the protest. And joining us on the phone is Wisconsin State Senator Chris Larson. Let's go first to Wisconsin State Senator Chris Larson. Can you tell us where you are and why you're not in the Capitol in the legislature in session?
Right now, we are, I'm actually moving between locations right now, and the big reason is we're out of the Capitol because Walker, the governor, and the Republican legislature set the tone that they're not willing to talk, they're not willing to listen. They decided that this is not going to be a negotiation, it's going to be their way or the highway, so we chose the highway.
Let me go to John Nichols to give us a little background. John, you've been in the center of this for all of these days. Explain the scene right now, how Wisconsin has come to this point.
Well, what happened is that last November we had an election. The Republicans did very well. They elected a governor, and they took control of both houses of the legislature. In January, they passed a whole host of tax cuts for multinational out-of-state corporations. And then, start of February, they announced we were broke. And as a result, implemented or brought forward a plan that would ultimately cut the pay, cut the benefits, cut the pension of public employees, and do so by eliminating their collective bargaining rights. And the interesting thing is, this is not just state employees, this is also county and city employees and teachers. And so they had this sweeping bill. It came forward just last Friday, not something that was anticipated. They were going to vote on Thursday. And what happened, Amy, is that we saw something. I know you and I both were in Seattle back in 1999 at the WTO protest. You know, it was something quite remarkable. People mobilized very, very quickly, and it was people power. They filled the streets. When I came downtown in my city of Madison on the first day of the big protests, the traffic started to slow down a little bit, and I didn't know why. It was thousands of students from the high schools walking up the main thoroughfares to be at the Capitol. I really can't tell you how remarkable it is. And there's simply no doubt that these Democratic state senators, who were really expected to go along with the process, make some objections, be very angry about it, but ultimately go along. They looked out the windows of the Capitol. They saw these incredible, very peaceful, very positive protests, lots of kids, lots of families, and they did make this extraordinary gesture. It has, at this point at least, stopped the process.
John, this is Juan Gonzalez. I wanted to ask you about some of the governor's proposals, because obviously he's crying budget cuts, but many of the proposals have nothing to do with economics. They have basically to do with preventing unions from exercising their normal methods of representing workers, including eliminating dues checkoffs for union dues and requiring unions to be recertified every year, that they have the support of those they're representing. Could you talk about that?
Sure. Juan, the thing that you know is that most unions in this country are protected by national collective bargaining protections that are in the Labor Relations Act, all sorts of rules at the federal level. But public employees and state employees operate under state-based laws in this case. And as a result, their collective bargaining rights are extensions of the state. In Wisconsin, where I live, the Collective Bargaining Act was put into place in 1959 by Gaylord Nelson, who was governor at the time in a Democratic legislature. It's been here for a very long time, but it is still something that a governor can, with the support of a legislature, take away, not by a three-fourths vote or some sort of extraordinary effort, but a simple majority vote. And amazingly enough, Scott Walker put it into a minor budget repair bill, a bill that traditionally might have been voted on after like 15 minutes of debate, not even noticed. And he put in massive rewriting of our state collective bargaining laws. And the key thing to understand here is that if this goes through, our unions in Wisconsin, and this is the state where AFSCME was founded, the American Federation of State, County, and Municipal Employees, been around for a very long time, but our unions in Wisconsin will be dramatically disempowered. And that's what they want. The unions in Wisconsin are very, very strong political players. We don't have strong political parties in Wisconsin. It's our independent tradition. But the unions have been a part of it, often endorsing Republicans and Democrats, but stepping into the debate on behalf of a public sector, on behalf of the commons, and also on behalf of public education. And I cannot emphasize the extent to which this is a fight by Republican power brokers to weaken those institutions that defend our very strong public education system in Wisconsin.
I want to get the state senator to respond to President Obama, who weighed in on Thursday by describing the proposed Wisconsin legislation as a, quote, assault on unions.
Some of what I've heard coming out of Wisconsin, where you're just making it harder for public employees to collectively bargain generally, seems like more of an assault on unions. And I think it's very important for us to understand that public employees, they're our neighbors. They're our friends. These are folks who are teachers, and they're firefighters, and they're social workers, and they're police officers. You know, they make a lot of sacrifices and make a big contribution. And I think it's important not to vilify them or to suggest that somehow all these budget problems are due to public employees.
Then there's Republican Congressman Paul Ryan of Wisconsin, who appeared on MSNBC Thursday defending Governor Walker's anti-union push, comparing the protest in Madison to the uprising in Egypt.
He's asking that they contribute about 12% for their health care premiums, which is about half of the private sector average, and about 5.6% to their pensions. It's not asking a lot. It's still about half of what private sector pensions do and health care packages do. So he's basically saying, I want you public workers to pay half of what our private sector counterparts are. And he's getting, you know, right. It's like Cairo has moved to Madison these days. It's just, you know, all of this demonstration, it's fine. People should be able to express their way, but we've got to get this deficit and debt under control in Madison if we want to have a good business climate and job creation in Wisconsin.
That was Congressman Paul Ryan. State Senator Chris Larson, your response to both and what your plans are now, when you plan to come back to Wisconsin.
Right. I think it's great that the president is speaking out on this situation. One of the things that we're dealing with here in Wisconsin is something that's going to be dealt with across the country. And it's going to be a matter of whether governors and legislatures decide to tackle things in a measured response or try and use it as an attack on their political enemies and say this is the excuse I'm going to use to try and take out anybody who might object to me in the future. So I think it's great that the president's standing with us. We've heard from the Archbishop in Milwaukee, as well as members of the Green Bay Packers. And when you've got the president, the Archbishop, and the Packers against you, I think you might want to reconsider your position. And we hope that Governor Walker and the Republicans are doing that. And we're still in Wisconsin, or we're still outside of Wisconsin, rather, because we haven't heard from them. They're calling what we're doing a stunt. They're still not listening to the thousands of people that are stepping outside of the Capitol and inside the Capitol trying to be heard, people who spoke for over 2 days straight at a public hearing. Actually, the Republicans shut that down at 3 a.m., and the Democrats picked up the gavel and kept it going for another 24 hours. And they still decided not to listen to them or make any of the changes and still tried to ram through, as John mentioned, over 50 years worth of history they tried to reverse in about 5 days. And I think what Congressman Ryan was referring to, trying to change the pensions and pay, I listened for hours to the public hearing, and I did not find one public employee who is not willing to sacrifice in this, to give up some pay, to give up something. But what they don't want is to be dictated to. What they don't want is their seat pulled out from under them at the table and saying, sorry, you're going to have to sacrifice. And this, after they spent the last month and a half carving out tax breaks and giveaways for the richest people that actually created this mess that they're trying to, they're purporting to fix now. That's just not fair, and that's not the Democratic way.
I'd like to bring into this the discussion Susan Stern, a first-grade teacher in Madison, Wisconsin. Your reaction to what these proposals would mean to you and your ability to do your job, and also the decision of your union to conduct a strike now for three days now.
You know, I am so proud of the teachers and the workers in Wisconsin. And I'm also worried, a little nervous, and I'm jubilant. There are over 30,000 people out at the Capitol saying, we're not going to lose our voice. This is really important. And I really want to thank the senators for walking out. Sometimes it's necessary to walk out to be heard, and that's allowing us to stand up and be heard. And that's what we're doing.
I wanted to ask John Nichols. People voted for the Republican governor. He was elected, Scott Walker. He won. Is this part of his platform? I mean, is this what people voted for?
No, it isn't. And that's the incredible thing. I've done a few national interviews where I've had CNN anchors and others saying, well, why was anyone surprised that a conservative Republican governor did this? And I said, well, you know, as somebody who's known Scott Walker for the better part of 20 years, I was surprised. And I covered, I've covered him in all sorts of settings. He never said he was going to take away collective bargaining rights from our public employee unions. He never said that he was going to really rip the state apart. And I cannot emphasize to you, Scott Walker was elected as a conservative, no doubt about that. But he was elected as somebody who most people thought of as a common sense conservative. He beat the guy in a primary who we all thought was a little bit out there. As it turns out, Scott's a little bit out there. And the thing that's important to understand here, a lot of people don't understand the Wisconsin tradition. We had a governor in Wisconsin, Robert M. La Follette, who had a great phrase, democracy is a life. What he meant by that is that democracy doesn't end on election day. You don't elect a king to rule you for 4 years. Democracy begins on election day. You elect someone, and then that person, that legislator or that governor, is supposed to listen to you, to represent you, not to rule over you. And I think what Susan Stern and other people have done over the last 3 days is a reassertion of the Wisconsin tradition, which is very engaged, very passionate democracy, but isn't just a Wisconsin thing. To be honest, as you folks know, people across the country are watching this. Students at schools in other states have walked out in solidarity with the students and the teachers here. On a radio show this morning that was taking calls from around the country, a guy from South Carolina called in and said, we are all cheeseheads now.
John, I wanted to ask you, one of the things apparently that the governor has done is to try to divide folks within the labor movement by exempting certain unions, the police union, the fire unions, from the same kind of proposals. Could you talk about how that is playing out in Wisconsin?
Yeah, and I do hope you'll bring Susan in on this one, too, because she's been a part of this remarkable experience. At the start of the week, the firefighters and the police, very strong unions in Wisconsin, were protected. It was said, well, the governor has exempted them. And frankly, it was because he didn't want to have a fight with them. As the week went on, because of the very, very close relations between Susan's union, Madison Teachers Incorporated, and the Madison Firefighters Local 311, an alliance was forged. And the Madison firefighters, with allies around the state, basically said, we don't care if we're exempted. We are going to stand in solidarity. And those moments when the firefighters walked into these huge rallies, often in uniform, behind bagpipers, it was a sense of solidarity and commitment that it was chilling. And it also, I do believe, was another part of what shook these Democratic legislators into acting.
Susan Stern, how your union handled that, the attempt to divide the labor movement by the governor?
I'm sorry, pardon me?
Could you tell us about how your union responded to that, the attempts of the governor to divide some of the municipal unions from firefighters and police and other unions?
Thank you. Sorry, I was having a hard time hearing you. When the firefighters walked in yesterday to the Capitol, I was standing with a huge group of teachers. It brought tears to people's eyes. We're not divided, and police officers have been standing with us. The firefighters have been standing with us. There are steel workers out there. There's nurses out there. And it's a really, it's a loud environment out at the Capitol. It's very peaceful. And we feel really united.
Talk about the education cuts that have been proposed, Susan Stern.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up because this is a much bigger issue than the money, but the money is important, and there are teachers who are not going to be able to pay their rent or pay their mortgage with these cuts. There are teachers talking about needing to take second jobs or getting different jobs, and that's really important. The teachers and the other workers are not the people who are making big money in this state to begin with, and they work to take care the teachers work to take care of the children in our state, to educate them, to give them a quality education. And it's hard work, and we do it because we love it. And to take pay cuts and think about having working conditions that would be really difficult to teach in, because, you know, when we bargain, it's not just for financial issues. It's also for things like class size. It's also for things like prep time. And so I know you asked about the finances. I mean, that's a big hardship. And people are thinking about that, and people are worried. And it says a lot about the teachers who are out there by the thousands, because they're losing money. They're not getting paid these days that we're out there protesting. But they know, we all know that this is a much bigger issue, and people are willing to do that for our students and for the people of Wisconsin and for ourselves.
John, could you put what's happening in Wisconsin in the national context? We were talking with Noam Chomsky yesterday on the show about the past few months, this enormous campaign that is going on against workers' pensions, against demanding the elimination of tenure for teachers in many states, and, of course, anti-union laws being introduced in a variety of states.
Yeah, look. The Republicans had a good election last November. They swept to power in the U.S. House of Representatives. They also swept to power in a lot of states. And unfortunately, most of our national media tends to cover what goes on in Washington. They don't pay as much attention to the states. That's why what's happened here in Wisconsin is very exciting, because it sort of forced some of these, what are thought of in Washington as second or third tier issues, into the forefront. And the fact of the matter is, no matter what happens in Washington, the real frontline battles on the delivery of services, the delivery of education, how we maintain a public sector and a public sphere, occur at the state and municipal level. And these are where the cuts have been most severe. And the interesting thing is, public employee unions and teachers' unions have been the force that has pushed back, often without much support from even some of our mainstream progressives, because they think, oh, those unions can do it, they can handle it, they'll take care of themselves. Well, what's starting to happen, I believe, is that folks much beyond the union sphere are beginning to recognize that these unions do a lot more than just represent their workers. They stand up for a public space, for any kind of delivery of services for low-income people, middle-class people. And that's also what a lot of conservative think tanks and very wealthy and powerful players notice as well. They know that if they can undermine the unions, if they can destroy the ability of public employee unions to collectively bargain and to participate in our public process, to petition for the redress of grievances, if you will, then they are going to have a dominant power that won't just go from one election to the next, but could extend for a long time. That's what this fight is all about.
John Nichols, is there a financial crisis in Wisconsin?
No, there is no financial crisis in Wisconsin. I'm not the person saying that. The Wisconsin Fiscal Bureau, a nonpartisan agency, said that, you know, without Governor Walker's tax cuts for big corporations that he passed last month, Wisconsin would have ended this year with a surplus. Mm-hmm. Also, State Senator Fred Risser, the senior state senator in our legislature, elected in 1956, the guy who helped to sponsor the first law putting in collective bargaining back in 1959, still serving in the legislature, says there's absolutely no problem. They, you know, certainly we've had a drop in revenues. We're going to have to take cuts. We're going to have to deal with stuff. But this is something that the legislature has dealt with many times in the past. It's easily done. And the thing that I think is very important to point out here, Fred Risser, a very dignified man in his mid-80s, who doesn't get angry and doesn't shout about things, has said, there's not a crisis. Governor Walker is acting as a dictator to achieve political ends.
Finally, we're going to Peter Rickman, activist in the Teaching Assistance Association at University of Wisconsin-Madison. We just have 30 seconds, then we're heading to Cairo to cover the uprising there. But I wanted to ask, Peter, you've been camping out at the state capitol since Tuesday. We're going to go to break, then come back, and then we go to Egypt. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. His phone died, so we'll try to get him back. Stay with us. This is Democracy Now!, Democracy Now!, the War and Peace Report. Just before we go to Egypt, we did say we try to get Peter Rickman on the phone. The cell reception in the Capitol is bad because there are so many people there, tens of thousands of people. Pete Rickman is activist in the Teaching Assistance Association at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. We thought we could get him, but we just can't do it. So we will continue to cover this certainly on Monday. But right now, we go to Cairo, Egypt. Juan?
Yes, well, tens of thousands have gathered for a victory march through Tahrir Square, Liberation Square, to celebrate the overthrow of longtime Egyptian President Hosni Mubarak. Allegations of government corruption helped spark the uprising that lasted 18 days. And on Thursday, authorities arrested three ex-ministers on corruption charges, including former Interior Minister Habib El Adli and the ex-ministers for Housing and Tourism Ahmed Maghrabi and Zuhir Garana. Steel tycoon Ahmed Ez was also arrested. All four have denied any misconduct. Officials say they'll be detained for 15 days.
Meanwhile, labor strikes and protests are occurring across the country. From where we go directly to Cairo, Democracy Now! Senior Producer Sharifa Bokadous and Democracy Now! Correspondent Anjali Kamat. Sharif, you've just come from Tahrir. What is happening there today?
Amy, Tahrir today is filled with people, one of the biggest protests we've seen so far. And today is not a day of protest. It's a day of celebration. It's a day of victory. It's a very festive day. And they had a mass prayer in Tahrir just a couple of hours ago. The prayer was led by Yusuf al-Qaradawi, who's a very well-known and respected cleric in Egypt and around the Muslim world. And people here are continuing to come to the streets to put pressure on the military, to let them know that they can still fill the spaces in Egypt and call for reform. You know, many say a big obstacle has been overcome with the resignation of President Hosni Mubarak, but there's still a long way to go. I think Tahrir, seeing it today, is really going to be a space for Egyptians to come in the future for all kinds of protests, to have their voices heard. So one thing that's never changed, that has changed forever, is that Egyptians will be willing to speak out now, not afraid to speak out. And you've been seeing that since this week. It's been 1 week since Mubarak stepped down, and we've seen strikes across the city, across the country. Even when you're driving around Egypt, you drive past a fancy hotel, you'll see the hotel workers out on strike. You drive past a sporting club, you'll see the workers there on strike. You drive past a bank, you'll see the workers there on strike too. And so people are calling for reforms, for better wages, for the resignation of officials who have been tied to the regime and corruption. But one of the main demands, Amy, is that there's still hundreds, if not thousands, of people who have been arrested since this revolution began, and they have still not been released. This is one of the largest concerns. Why is the military still holding these people if they support the revolution and they're helping the Egyptian uprising? There's a hotline that's been established that's, if you're in Egypt, 01492, where people can call in, give the names and identities of the people that are missing. And people at this hotline have, when they're trying to find the names of people and to call the authorities, have been told, no, these aren't the protesters, these are the Baltagaya, the thugs that attacked you, who are being held. Well, the people are skeptical about that, but they say even if that is the case, they deserve a fair trial, they deserve a fair hearing. We want reforms for everybody. So that's what's happening today in Egypt. It's a festive day, but people are aware that the road is long ahead of them.
And Sharif, what about the transition from military rule to civilian rule, the efforts to prepare for new elections or rewrite the constitution? What's happening on that front?
Well, this week, Juan, we saw the military appoint a committee to amend the Constitution. There are some concerns both with the composition of this committee and its mandate. But, I mean, it's a mixed review. The committee is led, it's an eight-member committee. It's led by Tarek El-Bishri, who is a very well-known constitutional scholar. He's also a prominent anti-Mubarak critic, which many people are happy about. However, the committee does have scholars on it who were very supportive of the Mubarak regime. It also has a former Muslim Brotherhood member, which some have raised concerns about. A certain number of human rights groups, I think about somewhere over between 20 and 30 human rights groups have filed a joint complaint about members of the committee. Having said that, a number of people are happy, many I speak to are happy with the structure of it. Now, with its mandate, it has 10 days to amend specific articles of the Constitution. These are articles that deal specifically with the presidency, the ability to establish new political parties. These amendments are very important to change so that Egypt can move on and have these elections that are scheduled for 6 months. However, many want a complete rewriting of the Constitution. They hope that after these amendments, there can be some kind of path towards some kind of constitutional assembly with a new parliament that can draft a constitution anew. There's also some issues. There's also some issues with the composition of the committee. However, there's also an issue with the timing. You know, many think that 6 months is far too quick to hold both presidential and parliamentary elections. Many of the political parties here are just forming. There's many new ones being formed by the youth. There's new ones being formed by secular groups here. And they think, many people are critical, saying that the only groups that can will be organized enough in 6 months to actually run an effective campaign are the National Democratic Party of Hosni Mubarak and the Muslim Brotherhood, which puts us right back to the situation we were before. However, most people are looking forward to having these elections in 6 months and having some kind of representative democracy.
Sharif, what's going to happen to Mubarak? He's in Sharm el-Sheikh. What's going to happen to the Mubarak circle? Are people going to be brought up on charges and go to trial?
Well, this week, Amy, we saw, as you mentioned in your lead, four very top former Mubarak regime members being arrested. Ahmed Iz, who was a steel tycoon, Habib al-Adli, which is the despised former head of the Ministry of the Interior. We also saw Ahmed Maghrabi, who is the housing minister, as well as Zuhair Garana, who was... And all of them have been charged on charges of money laundering, of corruption, of fraud. Habib al-Adli is also being investigated for the crackdown on the protesters on January 25th and 28th, which led to hundreds of deaths. He's also being investigated for possibly orchestrating a church bombing in December that, in order to foment division within Egyptian society. These people, I think, are going to be brought up on charges and they will be tried. As far as Mubarak and his family himself, it's unclear what's going to happen. I do not think, and I'm pretty confident, that the military will not allow Mubarak to be tried. I can't say that with 100% assurance, but let's remember, this is the military that stood by Mubarak for 30 years. They're not an independent group, and Mubarak himself was a former head of the Air Force. He's from the military. A lot of these people are very close to him. I doubt that he will be brought up on charges, despite calls by many in Tahrir that he be tried.
And Sharif, what's happened to former Vice President Suleiman, who has apparently disappeared from the scene as well? Any word on him?
I have not heard word on Omar Suleiman as well. As we know, he was still in the government with this new system formed. Actually, it's the first time I hear that he's disappeared. As you know, being on the ground here, it's hard also sometimes to get the latest news. Let me just also stress that with this issue with the military, Amnesty has gotten many reports of torture of detainees at the hands of the military, so has Human Rights Watch. And so while people here are still put a lot of trust in the military, they are being accused of these allegations of torture. They are the same military that stood by Mubarak for these 30 years. And so people are very wary of that as well. And they want to, one of the reasons that they're packing Tahrir today is not only victory, but to show that they can still fill the streets and have their voices heard, and the military should not forget that.
Very briefly, Sharif, if you could introduce this young woman, this Egyptian teenager, and why you interviewed her, the significance of what's happening today.
Well, Amy, the youth here has been critical to this revolution. A lot of people here call it the revolution of the youth. They first took to the streets, but they were joined by all Egyptians eventually. And they are really taking some of the boldest steps in this uprising going forward. And what they have done is, I'm holding in my hand here the first edition of a newspaper that's called Gurnal, which just means newspaper in Egyptian Arabic. It just means journal. It's kind of our word for it, and they have printed it, and they're distributing it online. It's basically voices of protesters, and it also has a list of the martyrs in the back of people killed in the revolution. But the reason that they are also printing it, in addition to putting it online, is intentionally to break Egyptian law, which bars the printing and distributing of newspapers without permission. So this is Sana El-Saif. She's a high school student, and I spoke to her about this paper.
My name is Sana. I'm 17. I'm in my last high school year. We thought that right now is the perfect timing to push the borders of freedom further. So we thought, why not? Let's make a newspaper and let's not get permissions for that. Let's just sell it in the streets. It's a very symbolic thing. We are not counting on it. We don't have like a big budget or anything, but we want to. Force this. We want to have the freedom of expression. We want to force for further.
So usually you have to get permission to print a newspaper in Egypt.
Yeah, I think that's the first time this will happen. So we'll see.
And what kind of paper is it? Describe it.
It's called Voices of Tahrir, Voices of Liberation. And, we thought that the first copy has to be like, well, each one of us after this experience of the revolution has something to say. So we called everybody we know. We called people from Tahrir Square, people from Alexandria, people who have been there doing something in this revolution, and everybody wrote something. And we're just gonna, it's like a blog. That's
Sana Saif, and we're going to go back to her next week because we'll be wrapping up our coverage with Sharif in Cairo next week when he comes back to our studio to bring us his final interviews there. Sana Saif, who is involved in this new newspaper that came out this week, El Gonal. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. When we come back, Anjali Kamat's interview with a labor leader talking about labor activism in Egypt. Stay with us. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.
Well, since the uprising to topple Mubarak, thousands of employees across Egypt have walked out on strike. They include workers from textile mills and a pharmaceutical plant in Alexandria. Employees are also on strike at Cairo's airports and banks. This is an interview that Anjali Kamat did with a leader of the labor movement.
That's right. We're turning right now to Khaled Ali to talk about how labor organized.
Strikes across Egypt did not stop after Mubarak's resignation. On the contrary, the strikes escalated, and new sectors began participating in the strikes, including the police force, bank workers who protested wage disparities and corruption. The public transport workers started a strike for 4 days. Medical ambulance workers in the health ministry began a strike. In Mahalla, a textile town just north of Cairo, workers came out to demand a minimum wage of 1,200 pounds a month. The average number of strikes taking place from February 12th until the present is between 30 and 60 strikes per day. To the extent that the Supreme Council of the Armed Forces have issued a communique asking strikers to stop walking off the job. So those who were part of the previous regime are now asking strikers to go home and stop striking. Despite the fact that this communique was issued last Sunday, strikes have not stopped. There were even strikes the following day. Many political activists have ended their protest and left Midan al-Tahrir and settled for the demands of the movement up till now for democracy and freedom. And there are even suspicions that some political activists have been sitting with members of the Supreme Council of the Armed Forces, cutting deals behind closed doors. But the success of the revolution for the workers is not simply the departure of key officials from the old regime. Its success means an improvement in their living standards, the existence of social justice, and guaranteed steps that their lives will get better in the future. That's why worker protests across different sectors are calling for a removal of corrupt officials in these institutions and companies. And they see the presence of these officials as a continuation of the old regime. The workers' actions right now are the best means of preserving the gains of the revolution.
The role of middle-class youth has been highlighted in this Egyptian uprising that's taken place. What do you believe to be the role of workers leading up to the uprising, making it possible? And also, what role did economic factors play in this uprising?
This is an incorrect analysis of the revolution. There's a misreading of what happened in the past years. You can't deny the role of middle-class youth in the revolution. And you can't deny that youth are the ones who sparked this revolution. But there's a big difference between those who sparked the revolution and those who continued on with the revolution and are still continuing on until all its demands are met. There's no revolution in the world that doesn't take place without reasons. And we had many reasons, economic and political and social, which pushed people to take to the streets and remain steadfast for 18 days. I agree that youth played an important role. And I say that this revolution represented the desires of all the Egyptian people across different classes. When they tried to occupy, when the government forces tried to occupy in Tahrir Square with their camels and their pro-government thugs, the government spread rumors about the protesters in Tahrir Square that they're taking money from foreign sources and that they're following foreign agendas. In response, Tahrir Square began to respond, and the middle class was important in this, that we have money, we're comfortable, and we don't need money from any foreign sources. But the workers were part of this revolution as well. The workers have successfully launched and sustained the largest wave of labor mobilizations this country has seen from 2004 until 2011. The workers are the ones who brought down the structures of this regime in the past years. They're the ones that have been fighting for independent organizing on the ground, and they're the ones who created Egypt's first de facto independent trade union. And they insisted on the right to have pluralistic trade unions, not just unions that are stacked with government supporters. They're the ones who brought their grievances to the streets. Last spring, workers were protesting in large numbers in front of the upper and lower houses of the Egyptian parliament, bringing their grievances to the streets. Workers laid the ground for the emergence of this revolution. And I believe that any analysis which says otherwise is superficial. We are in the process of collecting documents about the numbers of people who died and who were injured. Among the questions that we're asking people is, where did the deceased live? Was he a worker or was he unemployed? And do they work on a temporary basis? Are they government employees? Are they permanent workers? How much was their salary? Until now, most of the cases we've encountered are cases of people who were poor and lived in poor neighborhoods. They're the ones who came out and joined these street battles during the revolution. They're the ones who are not afraid of being shot. They're the ones who are killed. These people gave their lives without ever claiming that they were the owners of this revolution. We need real documentation to know how this revolution truly succeeded.
That was Khaled Ali, a labor lawyer with the Egyptian Center for Economic and Social Rights. Special thanks to Ahmed Shokhra for his help in translating, and of course to Democracy Now!'s Anjali Kamat. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, as we move into our last segment. Juan?
Well, on Tuesday, Secretary of State Hillary Clinton gave a major address calling for internet freedom around the world. Speaking at George Washington University, Clinton condemned the Egyptian and Iranian governments for arresting and beating protesters.
What happened in Egypt and what happened in Iran, which this week is once again using violence against protesters seeking basic freedoms, was about a great deal more than the internet. In each case, people protested because of deep frustrations with the political and economic conditions of their lives. They stood and marched and chanted, and the authorities tracked and blocked and arrested them.
Just moments before Hillary Clinton spoke those words, a 71-year-old man was violently ejected from Clinton's own event and arrested for turning his back on the Secretary of State. TV cameras caught part of what happened.
Then the government pulled the plug. Cell phone service was cut off, TV satellite signals were jammed, and internet access was blocked for nearly the entire country.
So this is America.
The government
this is America.
The
who are you?
To communicate with each other, and it did not want the press to communicate with the public.
The voice you heard screaming was that of Ray McGovern, as he was dragged away by security guards who left him bruised and bloody. He was then arrested. McGovern is a former Army intelligence officer and a 27-year veteran of the CIA. He was one of the CIA's daily briefers for President George H.W. Bush. He has since become a vocal critic of U.S. foreign policy.
Ray McGovern joins us now in Washington, D.C. Ray, you were seriously hurt. Tell us what happened.
Well, I was pounced upon. I was blindsided, really. I was looking straight to the back, minding my own business, the only offense being standing up when everyone else was sitting down. And without any warning, I was pounced upon by, and what I'd call large manhandled, by a fellow who looked like an NFL football player in plain dress. I don't know who he was. That's why you hear me screaming, "Who are you? Who are you?" I never did get the answer to that. So it was really quite abrupt, quite violent, and the supreme irony, of course, is and sounds like something right out of Franz Kafka. Four paragraphs later, Hillary Clinton is saying what you just quoted her as saying. You know, one has to keep one's sense of humor in all this, especially when one bears these kinds of bruises, and I can't show you the ones down below. I was listening on the way in. I tuned in a little late to your show. And what I heard Hillary Clinton say, that little clip, "We strongly oppose the use of violence." This is yesterday. "We have deep concern over the actions of security forces." And I'm saying, yes! Oh, she's going to apologize like my Veterans for Peace colleagues has asked her to do. But then I realized she's talking about Bahrain. straight out of Kafka.
So you were seriously hurt. What parts of your body, what did they do to you?
Well, they put two sets of handcuffs on me, very roughly. They were the iron or the steel handcuffs. They dug into my my wrist. Well, you could see some of this stuff right here. And they put it behind my back, of course, and I started bleeding profusely over my pants. We have the pants, they're full of blood. When somebody said, is that his blood? One of the cops said, no, I pricked my finger. Right. The whole back seat of the pants is suffused with blood. They threw me, well, they didn't throw me. They placed me in a patrol car. I try not to exaggerate here. I was taken up to one of the police headquarters in D.C., mugshotted, fingerprinted to a fare-thee-well, and put in a little cell of the size that Bradley Manning now occupies in Quantico.
Ray,
kept there for 3.5 hours.
Why were you there? Why did you, were you standing up?
I was standing up in silent witness to the fact that Hillary Clinton is responsible, partly responsible, for countless thousands of Iraqis, Americans, Afghans, and, God help us, Iranians, I hope not, and that she should not get the idea that everybody's going to sit down and applaud politely when there are so many of us that are usually excluded from these sessions who are feeling very, very, very sad and very angry at the foreign policy for our government. Very seldom do you have a chance to express that. I thought that I expressed that in the most nonviolent way by simply standing quietly with my back to her with a T-shirt that said, Veterans for Peace.
Well, Ray McGovern, I want to thank you for being with us, the former top briefer of Vice President George H.W. Bush. Ray worked for the CIA for more than a quarter of a century. That does it for the show, democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.